Hello everybody, today I'm drawing a Spider-Man sketch cover, and you get to watch. As you can see here, I start out with just really loose, rough lines. I'm not trying to put down exact, deliberate lines at this point. I'm just sort of pushing the pencil around and trying to figure out what the pose is going to be. Particularly with Spider-Man, he tends to contort himself into crazy positions. So, you know, I have to figure out, you know, where am I going to put an arm, where am I going to put this leg, that kind of thing. Now you see I'm using a blue colored pencil. That's called a non-photo blue pencil. And the reason it's called non-photo blue is kind of a throwback to before computer scanners. So when they did artwork, pictures of the artwork had to be taken with a stat camera. And a stat camera would take black and white photos and it would not see the color blue. So if you drew in blue, it would show up invisible or as white. So artists got into the habit of doing their sketch lines with this non-photo blue pencil. That way none of their loose, rough sketch lines would show up on the final stat. Now today, that's not as important. Obviously, we don't use stat cameras as much as we used to. Pretty much everything is computer scanned and things like that. But I think it's just people just kept on the practice of using the blue. It has a practical application, not necessarily the blue color, but using a different color than the regular pencil to start out with your sketch lines. Because, you know, the first step here is to really just get a rough idea of, like I said, what your pose is going to be. Later on, you'll see me switch to a normal pencil where I'll begin to refine my lines and pick and choose which of these really loose sketchy lines that I like. So by switching to a different color, it helps my brain kind of delineate between the sketchy loose lines that I don't want and then the deliberate lines that I do want. So you can see here I've started on a leg and I've thrown that his left leg, you know, way up there, you know, so his knee is up by his ear. Again, just keeping with the Spider-Man, you know, contorted web swinging type of pose that I'm shooting for here. I decided to throw the other leg out to the other side, and of course I have to bend it back somehow. So I'm just sort of figuring out the proportions here. The top of the leg versus the, you know, the bottom of the calf and the shin. Trying to figure out where the foot goes here. It's okay to overlap it over the arm. That actually kind of helps the visual space, you know, foreground and middle ground there. Just trying to get the contour of the leg right here. Now you'll notice I don't try to obsess on one particular body part at a given time. I'm kind of just jumping all over the place at this point. And that's a deliberate decision. Sometimes I'm not always good at it. Sometimes I do get locked into a specific body part and I'll try and noodle it, overdraw it. At this stage of the sketch, you really want to keep everything loose. So I kind of dance around the whole drawing. I go from here to there to there. And that just kind of helps keep the energy. It kind of helps me continuously, you know, see the whole image at once. Because if I'm obsessing over one particular body part, a foot or a hand, for too long, I kind of lose sight of the rest of the picture. Now here I've decided that I kind of want to adjust the slightly position of the head right there. So I got out the old eraser and I made an adjustment. Now there's different ways to, you know, do this sketching stage. You'll kind of see I'm using kind of a scribbling method here, which is a little bit of a fast and loose, messy way of doing things, just kind of finding your way through the anatomy. Another way is to draw construction lines. You'll see sometimes artists draw kind of a wireframe and then construct loose body shapes, cylinders and cones, and then from there build out their body shape from there. There's no one right way to do things, and I kind of use both. Sometimes I'll construct a figure with more geometric shapes, and sometimes I'll just sort of scribble it in the way I want. Here I'm just trying to get the head shape the way I like it, and I'm roughing in the iconic Spider-Man eyes right here. And those Spider-Man eyes, they take practice. They're not easy to get down right at the beginning. So now I'm working in other aspects of the costume, and now I'm switching to the regular lead pencil. Now this is a lead holder. You'll see there that I can actually slide out the lead and replace it with different leads. So the holder itself obviously is permanent, and then I just replace the leads as I need it. And the leads come in hardnesses or softnesses. So if a harder lead will keep its point better, and it will tend to draw a lighter line, whereas a softer lead will draw a darker line. I'll tend to have to sharpen it more often. The lead I'm using here is called an HB, which is right in the middle. It's a medium hardness pencil lead. It's actually a little bit harder than I prefer. When I can, I like to draw it with a 2B, which is just slightly softer than this one, a slightly darker line, but the HB is, it's perfectly acceptable here. So now this is the stage where I can kind of pick out the lines that I want to use and ignore kind of the messy lines that I don't want to use. So this is a refinement stage. This is why I kind of laid down my initial sketch with the blue and differentiating between the blue and the, you know, the regular gray pencil lead that just kind of helps your brain pick out the lines that you want. So now I'm detailing things here like the collarbone and the pectoral and muscles, and defining that jawbone right there. Now, not all artists today will sketch first with a blue pencil. I've actually seen artists who've gotten in the habit of using a red pencil instead. And again, we no longer have to worry about the non-photo properties of the pencil. You can start sketching in any color you want. The ironic thing about the original Stat cameras is that when you like drew a line in the color red, the Stat camera picked up the red line as black. But today you'll often see some artists who like to sketch, do their preliminary sketches in red pencil rather than blue. And it doesn't matter because you're dealing with computer scanners now. And you can just, you know, erase what lines you like and then scan it into your computer, and you can do all sorts of, you know, adjustments in Photoshop once the artwork is inked. Now, what my plan is for this video is that this will be one video for just the drawing of the sketch cover, and I think I'll separate out the, you know, the inking of the black lines and the filling in with color for my next video. Trying to find the proper shape of the foot there, and now I have to work on that hand, and this is where I'm kind of thinking more. Hands can be problematic. There's so many different ways that they can twist and turn, and there's so many different moving parts with the different fingers. Now, at this part, I've decided that I didn't like how far that thumb was jutting out, so I just erased it and I kind of redrew that thumb so it didn't look as dislocated. Now I'm kind of getting away with that from that hand. Again, I don't like to dwell on any one part for too long. I'm blocking in some shadows right here. Rather than if Spider-Man was like crunched over like that, there would be a whole lot of ugly wrinkles and folds in his midsection. So drawing in that shadow, it's not only accurate, but it's just sort of like artistically just more pleasing, so we don't have to see, you know, Spider-Man's crotch and all those, you know, lines on his lower nether region there. Drop a shadow and move on. And here I'm adding blacks to the arms and legs, just kind of adding in the shadows to kind of just give a little bit more form to the musculature. And then one thing you'll notice me doing here is I'm adding the black musculature shadows and stuff primarily to the blue portions of his costume. Right here I am kind of dropping in a shadow right underneath the chin and detailing the top of the shoulder there, but I'm not going to do much more than that. And the reason is that the red part is eventually going to get the web pattern, and the web pattern, once it's drawn in, it contours around, you know, the shape of his body, and it's largely unnecessary to go crazy with all sorts of black muscles and, or, you know, black shadows for the muscles and things like that in the red portions of his costume. I'm not saying you can't do it, there's plenty of artists who do, but I tend to choose just to kind of detail the muscles more in the blue parts and not so much in the red parts of the costume. Now I'm drawing in his web line, and I want to kind of make it look like it's shooting a little bit out at the viewer. So I want to get that little bit of a perspective on it, get all those spaghetti strands of webbing kind of doodled in. And again, I just sort of like loose and messy. You know, the webbing actually is more fun when you try and just kind of do it messy. You don't have to make each little strand of web a deliberate line. And now I've decided that I want to put another web line behind him, kind of like he's tossing it away. So the one back there is the one that he's just released. So now I'm going to start working on the web pattern of the red portion of his costume. And there's a method that most artists use to make the web patterns look correct. Back in the early days of Spider-Man, Steve Ditko, it took him a while to figure out, you know, exactly the direction of the scalloping and the way the web lines go. Even, I think, John Romita's first attempted Spider-Man, which is on the cover of an early Daredevil issue, the web pattern is upside down compared to the way most artists do it now. But generally speaking, there's a system to it. What you see now is I'm starting to draw the web patterns on the face mask, because the entire direction of the webs emanate right from that center spot between his eyes. His face mask tends to look the best when you start with that one center line coming down the center of the mask at the top, and then it hits that middle spot between the eyes, and then it branches off into two lines running down to his chin. And then from there, you kind of spiral out with those vertical lines. Now, the lines that are going up from the center point of his mask will eventually go, up to the top of his head, over the top of his head, and around down the back, and then, down his shoulders. And then the lines coming down towards his chin will wrap underneath his chin, down his neck, and then down his chest and torso. And likewise, the lines that are kind of going sideways off the mask will wrap around to the side of his mask, and then curve down around his ear, and then down the side of the neck and the shoulder and the arm. So all of those vertical lines have a starting point, really, that come out from the center of the mask and just kind of branch out and then cascade all the way down his costume. And then you've got the horizontal scalloping web lines. All right, and I'm just showing that, obviously you've got a downward scalloping and an upward scalloping line. The only spot you see the scallops going upward are on the top of the mask right there. And those upward scalloping lines curve up over the top of his head and eventually turn into downward scalloping lines when they get to the back of his head. Every other portion of the web pattern has the downward scallop. And again, just like the vertical lines, those horizontal scalloping web lines keep repeating all the way down the arm, all the way down the chest, until you get to the fingers. And when you get to the fingers, you just draw circles around the fingers. But you want to keep the direction of those scalloping web lines consistent. You don't want to reverse it. So it always goes downwards towards the end of the extremity. Now you'll notice that his arm and back, that's throwing the web line backwards, it looks like those horizontal web lines are scalloping upwards. But that's just because his arm is rotated upwards towards the sky. If you were to rotate that arm back down, they would be scalloping down towards his hand. So here I've just added a few more little details to the back web line, and I've decided to throw in a bit of a city skyline. And I'm not doing exact perspective on these buildings. If this were for a real book cover or a comic book cover, I would get out the rulers and try and figure out more exact perspective and be more exact. But really, the most important thing for this sketch cover is really the Spider-Man figure. The buildings are just sort of a backdrop and not as important. So what I'm going here for is kind of a cheated perspective. I'm just sort of roughing in, like eyeballing it, but I'm also intentionally making the buildings curve around just to give the perspective a little bit more drama, almost a fisheye lens type of an idea. I'm probably going into more detail here than I even needed to. Sometimes I can't help myself. I get so involved in the drawing that it's hard for me to keep it as simple as I should. And even this, so I keep telling myself as I'm drawing these right now, this is just quick, don't go crazy with the architecture. Because I really think when I get to the color stage on this, I'm not even going to do much detail at all with the markers. I think I may just do kind of a flat gray and leave it at that, in which case you don't need very much detailing in the architecture. I'll probably put a little bit detailing into this foreground building simply because is the closest one to us. The ones in the background, I'm just going to leave as silhouettes. Put some clouds there in the background. And then just like I did with the Spider-Man figure, after I get my rough blue lines that I just sort of freehanded, now I'll kind of pick out more exact lines that I want with the regular pencil. Now here I'm trying to make it look a little bit like building architecture, but I'm still just sort of suggesting the architecture of the building, suggesting the windows there, not going too crazy, noodling and detailing every little detail. Some sort of an antenna that I'm putting up there. Drawing buildings is definitely a learned skill, and I think that the comic book artists in particular are often just amazing at doing architectural drawings because they have to do it so much, particularly some of the guys who have to draw Spider-Man, because so many shots are in the New York City skyline. For my work, I don't have to draw them as much. Typically with the product and merchandise, it's just a single Spider-Man figure pose without a city skyline behind it. But it's like anything else. The more you do it, the better you get at it. I've read articles where longtime veteran comic book artists who have city buildings down to a science, because they've done it like thousands and thousands of times. They know the architecture and they can do it in their sleep. And then you ask them to draw a story in the suburbs or a jungle, it stumps them because that's something that they don't have a lot of experience with. And you know, if you have trouble with architecture, just get some reference and look at a picture and kind of figure it out like anything else. All right, so here we are and we're done. Thanks for watching, everybody. Don't forget to hit the subscribe button. That way you'll get notification for my next video when I add the black lines and color. So until then, see you later. Bye-bye.